This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel. This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. No matter what you saw last night, I saw a Vivek debate, one that's going to go on and on for a long time, because charisma plus some vulnerabilities equals let's throw our spears that way. And that's what happened last night. We'll talk about it coming up throughout today's show. Your phone calls are welcome here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
There's a reason that we live so far from Hollywood. In the country, looking hard to find a home. Well, nothing perfect or considerable, we're so damn good. It's the story of your
Morning, Glory, America, Bonjour, I, Canada. If you're watching the Salem News Channel last night, midnight, and you wondered if I would be back a mere 6 hours later, here I am, back on the Salem News Channel doing my radio show today as well, and I'm happy to be here because debate nights, you know, I dreamed about Nikki Haley and Vivek getting into a fight. It was that close last night. I want to begin my review by telling you up front, Fox News has rightly instructed every program in America, you may only use 3 minutes of clips per hour. And I'm going to do that, and I'm going to stick with it because they have a right. They've defined fair use as that. I don't really think that's legally the correct standard, but I also don't want to fight with Fox News. I like Fox News. They did as good a show as possible when you've got 1,000 people in an arena. Seriously, at some point, when you've got the moderator turning around and telling the cheering crowd, this is not a football game. You know that something's gone amiss. And what went amiss last night is whenever the candidates started to engage with each other, they were not separated by the moderators. The crowd stepped on it. So if you're angry that you didn't get to hear anything, I don't like the rule set. I don't like, you know, Hugh's rules are 75-second answers. No question can be longer than 30 seconds and no right of response. Because the right of response, I've said it 1,000 times. It screws up every debate that I have moderated, the foreign presidential debates in 2016, two Senate debates, two governor debates, the recall debate in the last 2 years. My rules work. Nobody else's rules don't work. It does not serve the voter. But we got some good stuff. It's the Vivek debate. That's what it is. Hashtag Vivek debate. And he may have won, he may have lost, but it was most definitely the Vivek debate. So let's run through some clips. My phone number is 1-800-520-1234. I want to know what you thought about the debate. I will get to the former president's conversation with Tucker Carlson as well on X, the site formerly known as Twitter. But I think I want to begin, since it is the Vivek debate, I think the absolute heart of the debate, I mean, the one that'll make it into a book, try and think in these terms. When you write a campaign book, and I've done two, where you look backwards or you're looking forwards, and you say, what are moments in the campaign? And you can't write every minute. If you're T.H. White, you can do a lot. Or if you write that crazy book of the 68 campaign, you can do a lot. But this is probably the number one moment. Cut number 28.
You know, Nikki, I wish you well in your future career on the boards of Lockheed and Raytheon.
You know, I'm not on
but
the fact of the matter, and Raytheon, and you know,
Boeing
you
came off of it, but you've been pushing this lie. You've been pushing this lie all week,
you
Nikki.
You want to go and defund Israel? Just, you want to
okay, let me address that. I'm glad you brought that up.
Go and give
I'm
going to
address
Russia.
Each of those right now.
You
this is the false lies of
America
a professional politician. There you have it. So
you
the reality
make America less safe. You have no foreign policy experience, and it shows.
And you know what?
It shows.
Do you know who does have experience on a debate stage? Nikki Haley. Do not make Nikki Haley mad. Do not make Nikki Haley mad. Now, there's sweet Nikki Haley. I drove down to the debate with my granddaughter at 1 year old, and Nikki walks into a room, and she does what a mom does. She goes for the baby. So I now know how to trick every candidate in America, which is bring a baby to the debate. It's like bringing a baby to a dog to a bar. If you're a single guy, bring a dog to a bar if you want to meet some women. But if you're an old guy like me and you want to get the candidate to come over and talk to you and there are 1,000 media, bring a baby. And Nikki Haley, right there, go to the baby. And so she's a mom. She's a military spouse. And did you see the end of Gladiator? Did you see the end of Gladiator? The end of Gladiator. Now, I couldn't say this last night on the Salem News Channel because we couldn't turn the cuts around. It's just a lot of production to do unless you got someone like me in your ear during the debate. And I won't do that because I got to watch the debate and tweet about it. That moment, let's play it again. I don't think that counts against my 3 minutes this hour, right, if I play it again. Cut number 28. This is the heart and soul of the debate.
You know, Nikki, I wish you well in your future career on the boards of Lockheed and Raytheon.
You know, I'm not on
but
the
fact of the matter,
and you know,
Boeing
you
came off of it, but you've been pushing this lie.
Stage,
you've been pushing this lie all week,
you
Nikki.
You want to go and defund Israel? Just, you want to
okay, let me address that.
China?
I'm glad you brought
you
that up.
Go and give
I'm going to address
Russia?
Each of those right now.
You
this is the false lies of a professional politician. There you have it.
Under your watch, so you will make America less safe. You have no foreign policy experience, and it shows.
And you know what?
I wish, do we have a slow motion feature like the Apple camera my grandson loves? Can we do that? Can we slow down the tape? Because I'd love that. That's Vivek number one. Oh, Mike Pence decides to be old Mike Pence, which is when he was grippling and grappling for his first congressional race. And he decides he's about had it with Vivek as well. Cut number 35.
I'm running for president of the United States because we don't need a president who's too old. And we don't need a president who's too young. We need a president who's been there. We need a president who knows how Congress works, how the White House works, how states work. And on this education issue, Martha, I was fighting against No Child Left Behind when Republicans were doubling the Department of Education. I'll also shut down the federal Department of Education.
And then let's go to Gatling Gun Chris Christie, cut number 11, talking to Vivek.
I've had enough already tonight of a guy who sounds like ChatGPT standing up here. And the last person in one of these debates, Brett, who stood in the middle of the stage and said, "What's a skinny guy with an odd last name doing up here?" was Barack Obama, and I'm afraid we're dealing with the same type of amateur standing stage tonight.
Ouch, ouch, ouch. Now, I invited Vivek because I didn't like this format is not Vivek's best format, right? He has got, Fetching Mrs. Hewitt is watching it with me, and she says, "Boy, he's awfully cute." And I, you know, that is one reaction. She's just a wonderful person. She knows more about politics than 99% of America, but I'm in the top 0.1%. So I'm looking at her, huh? But then I made a note of it. Boy, he's a cute guy. And she likes young dads with young families, and he's got charisma. And there is a part of that. But then Gatling Gun Chris Christie comes around again. Cut number 18. Just put the finger on the poll button, Chris.
Behavior and illegal behavior, Chris. And you as a prosecutor should know better.
Yeah, you know what? I know a lot better.
There's a difference between bad behavior.
And I know a lot better than you do. You've never done it like you've never done anything to try to advance the interests of this government except to put yourself forward as a candidate tonight. And here's the thing. We've stood up for law and order. I did it as U.S. attorney. I did it as governor. And I am not going to bow to anyone when we have a president of the United States who disrespects the Constitution.
Okay, now the most important cut of the night, and the person who I really thought won, is Governor Ron DeSantis. He's the front runner. There's a reason. Cut number 20, front runner of those not named Donald Trump. I want to be very
This election is
here.
Not about
Here's Governor, Governor DeSantis, cut number 20.
This election is not about January 6th of 2021. It's about January 20th of 2025, when the next president is going to take office. I know what the Democrats would like to do. They want to talk about all these other issues, but we've got to focus on your future. We've got to focus on reversing the decline of our country.
Right, right.
I learned in the military, I was assigned with U.S. Navy SEALs in Iraq, that you focus on the mission above all else. You can't get distracted.
There are, in my view, three people who get party gifts, a set of living room furniture, and a handshake. All right? There are three people. Because I don't know what Asa and Doug are doing there. I've got Governor Burgum coming up. And the poor guy tore his Achilles yesterday, but he still played. So I've got some great sympathy for him. But apparently charisma is not a necessity for a North Dakota campaign. And it was a charisma suck. Asa Hutchinson, thank you very much. You'll enjoy this fine selection of party gifts, and you're going home. I also think Tim Scott disappeared last night. I love the guy. I love the guy. But I cannot take, I'm full to the rim with Brim and with Tim Scott telling me about the very true story of how hard he had it as a young man and how he loves his mom. I know that. I know that. He's already auditioned for vice president. Everybody knows that. It's just all a time suck. We got five serious people left. I'd like those five serious people with one moderator, that would be me, talking for 3 hours on an issue-by-issue basis. And if I don't hear abortion again, and it's not because I'm afraid of abortion. I think you ought to give a speech on abortion. I believe Doug Burgum is right, by the way. But to understand why Doug Burgum is right, that it's not in the Constitution and therefore it's up to the states, would require a long conversation that people don't know. What you need to do is show empathy for people caught in an awful situation of unwanted pregnancy. Explain to them why their life isn't over, but it's a new life is beginning, and it's going to require their participation for at least 9 months, and then they can adopt or they can raise the child. Then, and we're not going to have late-term abortions, and you move on. I don't understand how we went down the abortion trail for what seemed like 30 minutes to me. But we did, and now 1-800-520-1234. The Vivek debate is in the books. Call me with your reactions. 1-800-520-1234. Connect you to me, Hugh Hewitt. Good morning, America. Quite a debate last night. I don't know what the numbers are. The former president was on, and I'm going to play some of that in the next segment unless I get a call from a candidate. Jim in San Antonio, what'd you think, Jim, last night?
Good morning. I thought it was great. I think it was better in hindsight that Trump was not there. I have a question for you. You said five are left. Is that including Trump, or I missed what you said?
No, it's not including Trump.
So you're saying Mike Pence and Chris Christie?
Yep. I would give the party gifts to Asa Hutchins and Doug Burgum and Tim Scott. Thank them for playing, and then let's get the stage down to where people, because the problem isn't that these aren't nice people. The problem is you cannot advance the message against Joe Biden unless you get down to four people, and you got to get to four people. And eventually when you get to four people, one of those is going to be Donald Trump is going to come back. And so it's got to be, you know, who gets the three tickets out of the debate to join Donald Trump at the last two debates is what it is.
Well, it's DeSantis, Vivek, and Nikki Haley. But I would have loved to see Larry Elder up there. And
wishes are, what's the old saying? If wishes were kisses, we'd all be in the back in jail. I don't know what the old saying is about wishes being something other. I don't know. But he's not going to be there. That's done and finished. Asa Hutchinson, thank you for coming. Honestly, every time he talked, I don't believe that he had 40,000 individual contributions. And I don't believe he made 1% in a poll anywhere. I don't. I just don't. I don't know what he was doing up there except sucking time away. It was not a service to America. Nice old guy. Nice old guy. Right?
Yeah.
Everybody
Nice
old guy. Hey, Jim, thank you.
Question.
John in Howell, Michigan. Go ahead, John.
Hi, Hugh. I think that Pence, Governor DeSantis, and Vivek were the leaders. I would have to run with Governor DeSantis, but I would say one thing that really bothered me last night was the comment that Bret Baier made about the elephant not in the room. I thought that was ridiculously uncalled for and unprofessional.
Okay, I disagree with that because it's a sort of a standard phrase on how one refers to people who are issues that aren't being talked about. But okay, some people are offended. I get it. Let me do a market report. Thank you for the call, by the way. A market report brought to you by Birch Gold. If you're going to buy gold today, you should have bought it yesterday, but maybe it's important to buy it today because it went up yesterday to $1,947. But the point about gold is it doesn't matter what the spot price is on any given day. What matters is that you put it into an IRA, a SEP IRA, or a 401k, and you do it with Birch Gold. Go to HughGold.com. They'll send you the free information kit. The IRS has very strict rules. If you want your gold or your silver or your platinum, and I guess some people buy platinum. I'm not a big platinum guy. Maybe rare earth minerals. I don't know. But whatever you buy and they put in your vault, that qualifies for 401k. So if it spikes up in value over the next 30 years, then it's going up in value. Do not buy collectibles. There are a lot of very bad gold brokers out there. I mean, a lot of terrible people, not Birch Gold. Honest, straight shooters. Just call them up or actually text my name, Hugh, H-U-G-H, to 989898, or go to HughGold.com, and they'll give you the scoop on how to set up an IRA using gold. Diversify, diversify, diversify. Hugh Hewitt's rule of investing. I don't have any rules on investing other than diversify. 5 to 10% of your wealth in gold or dirt. The Dow went up 0.54% yesterday. The S&P 1.1%. The NASDAQ went up 1.59%, but the 10-year Treasury is at 4.2. And it's good that you weren't on a plane with Pergozzi. That's the other good part about yesterday, is that a bad guy got killed. I mean, the guy's a butcher. Do we have a producer in today? Don't cry for me, Argentina. Can we cue that up? Because we're off YouTube now. I just finally gave it up. I use music too much in my show, and we have a license to play this, but YouTube doesn't know it, so every time we played it on YouTube, they would take it down. So I made a bad choice for years and let YouTube dictate how I need Don't Cry For Me, Argentina. There we go. This is in salute to Pergozny. Can we get to the we need Don't Cry For Me, Argentina. We got to get to that. That's the money quote here. That's it. Do not cry for me, Victoria Bergozny, whatever your name is. You killer, you ruthless SOB. I hope you converted it as the plane went towards the ground, because otherwise you're spending eternity in a very real hell. No separating the goats from the sheep at this point. You're dead, and wow, Putin waits 2 months. Revenge is a dish best served cold, and Vladimir Putin has that tattooed on his neck. I've got relieffactorhere.com. It's not going to do Mr. Prigozhin any good. Shut down his plane. What a dummy. What a dummy. The guy was a chef, and he comes back from it. I'll just fly in right over Vlad's palace and expect him not to bother me. Icarian, curcumin, resveratrol, and omega. These are my relief factor. Boy, do I need it this morning. Because I do admit to having a couple of aches and pains this morning. It happens when you're in the chair for 4 hours straight. An hour beforehand, watching pregame, watch the debate, then do an hour of show, then get 4 hours of sleep. And you can't go to sleep right afterwards, right? You're thinking about it. You're making notes. I had to do this cut sheet because Dwayne never comes in. So my relieffactor.com, and then the cut sheet's more difficult because Fox News has a silly rule about 3 minutes an hour. And now we got to get to Donald Trump after this. So that was that's why I love relieffactor.com. No matter minor aches and pains, they go away. Poof, gone. 1-800-520-1234. Your calls are welcome. Let's play some Tucker and Trump next on The Hugh Hewitt Show. Welcome back, America. It's Hugh Hewitt. You have no idea how much Adam hates the decision we've made here. We're going to cut back on the podcast. It's going to be one or two interviews or segments a day because too many of you are just not listening to the radio show. If you want the whole radio show, you're going to have to join the universe. Okay, so I've made this too easy on Tom Cotton and other people, and they just listen to the podcast. Well, you're done. We're done with that. More importantly, if we put it up on YouTube, we can't play any music because they take it down, and so we have to edit all the music. It's just not worth the candle. So we're going back to the way we used to do this, but watch the Salem News Channel app if you want to get all the fun that's possible. Now, part of the fun is I can't get this graphic up because I don't have a producer. If this show had a producer, man, we'd sing like Salem News Channel sang last night if this show had a producer. Mike Pence had the most time last night with 12 minutes and 26 seconds. Now, keep in mind that the debate ran from 9 to 11 o'clock Eastern time and that they spent a good 7 minutes getting to the first word out of a candidate's mouth because somebody at Fox News thought it was a good idea to fly a drone through an empty building. Now, that is where you've lost control of your debate. In Hugh Hewitt debates, we start on time. The moderators never, Brett and I have a disagreement about this, never do show of hands. I don't believe in it. I think it's silly. You cannot communicate in a show of hands. It's like kneeling in a football game. What do you mean, huh? What? Nothing is that easy, but Brett and I disagree about that. Other than that, they ran a very fine debate. But their producers with the drone thing, that's crazy. How'd they do on time? And the rule set that I worked with in the Salem CNN debates is no candidate can have less than 50% of the time allocated by chance, by everything, to the candidate with the most. That's where the right of reply rule screws everything up. I hate that. But Mike Pence had 12 minutes and 25 seconds. Next up with Vivek, who had 11 minutes, 38 seconds. Next up with Chris Christie, who had 11 minutes, 37 seconds. Ron DeSantis. All right, everybody tunes in the front runner debate. The real alternative is Ron DeSantis. The real alternative to Donald Trump is Ron DeSantis. He had 10 minutes and 1 second. So all of that elaborate staging to hear from the guy who is the real second place challenger get 10 minutes. It's the governor has to start doing a lot of media. Message to Team DeSantis. You have a great candidate with a great record. This is a message, by the way, that's applicable to everyone. Stop, and Vivek is got 15% in some places, and Chris Christie's in first place in New Hampshire, first place not named Trump in New Hampshire, because he does a lot of interviews. You got to just start doing them, all right? It's like raising money. Put your candidate in a room, give him the phone, and let him talk to people who have shows like this one that reach 10 million people. Nikki Haley only got 8 minutes. Tim Scott only got 7 minutes and 57 seconds. And then Don Burgum got 7 minutes and 50 seconds. And Asa Hutchinson got 7 minutes and 24 seconds. So it's not a terrible imbalance, but the difference between 7 minutes and 24 seconds of Asa and Mike Pence getting 12 minutes and 26 seconds is a lot. But the thing that jumps out at me is Governor DeSantis is widely recognized, especially by the former president, as the guy in second place. The guy in second place should have the most time. All right, they put you in the middle of the stage, but he's very disciplined. This is, by the way, why I think he won last night. It's a game plan. Now, the best coach in the NFL is named Kevin Stefanski. You don't know that because he hadn't had a quarterback for 3 years. Since Baker Mayfield got injured, he hadn't had a quarterback, and that's kind of key in the NFL. But he plans the first three series of downs that you've got the ball. After that, things have changed. You got to start rocking and rolling, and you got a playlist that you want to call in the course of a game. Ron DeSantis, you know, he's very professional. I'm going to do this the right way. I'm going to cut, boom, boom, boom. By the way, I think Ron DeSantis is going to pick Glenn Youngkin to be his vice president to add niceness and sweetness and light to the ticket. And they're going to go out. But, counter-programming Donald Trump. And I saw, you know, I got a lot of Trump fans in my world, and they kept sending me, 73 million people have watched Donald Trump. That's just nonsense. All right? Utter, complete nonsense. I'm sure a few million people have watched the Tucker Donald show, and we're going to play for you now a few clips from it so you get a taste of what it was like. It's like every Donald Trump interview, all right? But Tucker's an extremely skilled interviewer, the second best in America, and he did a good job. Let's start with cut number 38, the former president on X with Tucker.
Why aren't you at the Fox News debate tonight in Milwaukee?
Well, you know, a lot of people have been asking me that, and many people said you shouldn't do them, but you see the polls have come out, and I'm leading by 50 and 60 points, and, you know, some of them are at 1 and 0 and 2, and I'm saying, do I sit there for an hour, 2 hours?
What? Can we isolate that 2? Can we do that? Can we hear the president just say 2? Because I think that's just such vintage.
Or 2 hours, whatever it's going to
be. 2? All right, keep going.
Me and get harassed by people that shouldn't even be running for president. Should I be doing that? And a network that isn't particularly friendly to me, frankly. You know, they were backing Ron DeSanctimonious like crazy, and now they've given up on him. I mean, it's a lost cause. It reminded me very much of 2016. You know, in 2016, I went through the same stuff and had to fight them all the way, and then they became very friendly after I won, or just about when I was winning. But I just felt it would be more appropriate not to do the debate. I don't think it's right to do it. If you're leading by 50, 60, I have one poll, I'm leading by 70 points, and I'm saying, why am I doing it? And I'm going to have 8 people, 10 people, whoever made the debate, I don't know how many it is, but I'm going to have all these people screaming at me, shouting questions at me. All of which I love answering, I love doing, but it doesn't make sense to do them. So I've taken a pass, as you probably noticed.
I did. I'm grateful that you did.
Cut number 39, more of the Donald.
A guy like Chris Christie, a guy left with a 8%, think of it, 8% approval rating in New Jersey. Now he's running for president, and he runs solely on the basis, oh, let's get Trump. He's like a savage maniac. He's like a lunatic. And that's all he talks about. His poll numbers are very, very low. He's about 2%.
What's he like? You know him well.
No, I've been friendly with him over the years, but I couldn't give him a job because I just never trusted him very much. I was just never one of his people that really trusted him. I never gave him the job. And that's one of the reasons he feels so hurt and so betrayed. And I understand that. I really do. I understand it. But I never gave him. You know, he wanted to be different things. He was looking at different elements of the administration, and we decided, I didn't want to do it. And now I'm glad I did.
You know, if he made Chris Christie attorney general, he'd still be president today. End of story. There would have been no Bob Mueller. There would have been, the crime wave would not have happened. We'd be serious, but he didn't. Cut number 40, talking about Biden. This is Trump at his best.
You don't think he's going to make it to November of 24?
Well, I think he's worse mentally than he is physically. And physically, he's not exactly a triathlete or any kind of an athlete. You look at him, he can't walk to the helicopter.
Stop. I have not heard this before because I said, I just want to give you my reaction. I heard. That's pretty good. Oh, he's not a triathlete. Generalissimo, have you heard these things yet?
Have I heard what things?
The Tucker, Donald stuff?
Yeah, some of it, yeah.
Is that the best line, or is there something that's better? He's not a triathlete.
That's all kind of par for the course. I mean, it was just kind of low energy, kind of working his way through and just kind of drop a little.
But, I mean, that's a very funny line.
Yeah, that's standard Trump.
You're not a triathlete. Did you eat a lot of junk cookies? Did the M&M jar come down last night and the My PhD weight loss go out the door yesterday?
No, it did not. I actually was working a lot last night, so I didn't.
Come on. You're not going to get it. We cut you from the team.
No, Coach called.
He wants to see you with your playbook.
No, you didn't cut me.
You got cut by Ziggy Top.
I couldn't.
What's the band with the beards?
ZZ Top.
You got cut by ZZ Top last night.
No, I actually had a dinner with Eric and his wife, so I couldn't make it.
Who'd you have dinner with?
Eric and his wife.
Oh, okay. So your imaginary friend. So you didn't get you didn't watch the debate.
I watched the debate.
Mrs. Generalissimo watch the debate with you?
No.
She's never actually watched a Republican primary debate with you, right? You've been married, what, a year?
I've been married 4 years.
There you go.
Time flies.
Right.
I know.
Yeah, time flies. And so you weren't even dating 8 years ago when we were doing this stuff.
No.
So she's never watched you watch a debate?
She saw me 4 years ago.
No, but that's not the debate. Is when the Republicans get together. When Dwayne was in the spin room, nobody's food was safe. Back in the days before my PhD weightloss.com.
I don't. Dwayne would go.
Gallagher and Dwayne. In fact, Gallagher and Dwayne, who are both on my PhD weightloss.com, a fine sponsor of this show, when they did the debate rooms in 2015 and 16. Nobody's food was safe. People would see Gallagher and Dwayne coming toward them, and they would hide their M&M jars. They would. I remember it. But you didn't do that last night.
No.
So what did you? What did the new Dwayne eat last night during the debate?
We had chicken for dinner. We had teriyaki chicken for dinner.
Okay. 864.
644.
1900, that's.
864.
644.
1900.
And I don't want you to feel bad about getting cut from the squad last night.
Oh, I don't feel bad at all about getting cut.
No, you got coach wants to see you and bring your playbook. I was hoping you didn't go home and get depressive and eat. Just eat.
I promise you that didn't happen.
Okay, let's go back to cut 41. No, everybody loves to stay up to 11 o'clock and not have any cuts. That's the truth. Cut number 41.
Or any kind of an athlete, you look at him, he can't walk to the helicopter. He walks, he can't lift his feet out of the grass. You know, it's only 2 inches at the White House, right? That's not a lot. But you watch him, and it looks like he's walking on toothpicks. So, and then you see him on the beach where he can't lift a chair. You know, those chairs are meant to be light, right? They're like 2 ounces. Yeah. You lift them up.
Two.
He can't
two
lift
ounces.
The chair. He can't
Mr.
walk
President.
To the chair. And
we
I don't know what they're doing with the beach. You know, this beach is seeming to play a big role, but they love
okay,
pictures
let's
of him.
Okay, let me come back to more of Donald Trump. I want to ask all of you to think about food for the poor this morning for a moment. We're having fun here this morning because it's post-debate day. But Haiti's getting hammered. Haiti is getting hammered by Tropical Storm Franklin. Here is an update.
So the latest coming in on Tropical Storm Franklin, showing that it still continues to move. Notice how widespread it is in some of the taller storms. Heavy rain and life-threatening flash flooding. There's a huge range, in fact, thousands of miles of where it could go. So we'll have to watch this closely as we go into Monday.
So we are packing boxes, and it takes $100 to get a box done. Would you please go to HughHewitt.com? We've been extremely generous to Maui. They've got lots. Maui is not an economic devastation issue, except for a few hundred families. It's a terrible tragedy. It's an absolute fiasco, and 800 people are missing. But we got to get food, water, and supplies to Haiti. Please help us out at Food for the Poor. The banner's at the top of HughHewitt.com. Welcome back, America. Let's get back to the Donald Trump Symphony number 8 in the key of Tucker. Cut number 42. Actually, cut number 41, because I think I may have an infringement case against the former president. Since everybody else is suing him, I might have to sue him too. Cut number 41.
We could go back, and we should go back to all paper ballots, voter ID, same-day voting. You know, France did it. France had mail-in ballots, and it was terrible. Anytime you have mail-in ballots, you're going to have massive cheating on your elections. Anytime, but not just the presidential election. Anytime you have...
Isn't that the whole point of them?
Yeah.
So you can cheat?
Oh, yeah, sure. It's their whole point. That's their whole point. They want to cheat. Yeah. They have to cheat because their policies are so bad that if they didn't cheat, they couldn't get elected. Who wants open borders? Who wants high taxes? Who wants high interest rates? Who wants to not be able to use a gas stove or have to drive an electric car, which, you know, you have a 4-hour drive, but the car only goes an hour and a half, so you have to charge it? The happiest moment for somebody in an electric car is the first 10 minutes. In other words, you get it charged, and now for 10 minutes. The unhappiest part is the next hour because you're petrified that you're not going to be fine to another charger. I'm not knocking electric cars, they're fine.
Yeah, by the way, stop. If you can see this, Tucker's smile is genuine. All right, it's just, why is Donald Trump the best interview in America? Because he's funny. All right, I know some of you, the TDS people want him in jail yesterday, and they wouldn't mind if he was in the stocks for 8 years. I get it. But he is genuinely funny. He's got a television guy's timing. And you know what I missed the most about last night's debate without Trump is the facial expressions when he's not answering the question, right? He's the only guy that can win a debate without saying anything. And I know you TDS people are going crazy, but that's what I missed. That was pretty funny. But I believe he owes me my 2004 book, If It's Not Close, They Can't Cheat. I think he just took that. I think I have an infringement claim. That's a Hugh Hewitt trademark. And it's a good thing. It's a good thing I've retired from the active practice of law. Cut number 42.
How do you do that? How do you get indicted, you know, every week and stay cheerful?
I think it's a lot easier because I'm...
Stop. Can I pay an homage to Tucker? Homage to Tucker moment. That is a fine question. Because it is kind of the whole deal, isn't it? How do you get indicted every week? And it diffuses it and it amuses it. And here's his answer. Cut number 42.
So high in the polls because it means the people get it. The people see it's a fraud. The people see it like this horrible district attorney from just a little while ago from essentially Atlanta. That's Fulton County. She said, basically, I don't have any right to challenge an election. Well, what about Stacey Abrams? What about Hillary Clinton? What about all of these Democrats that are still challenging my election? The same people that are saying he's challenging an election challenged my election. And they did it with slates. They did it with all sorts of things. They were very bad about it. But basically, they're suing me, and they're saying, you don't have any right to challenge. And if you challenge an election, we're going to indict you and put you in jail. So what they're doing is they've weaponized, and don't kid yourself, the DOJ and Biden and the whole group, they're watching all of this stuff. They love the local stuff, you know, the DA in Manhattan. Not only that, they put one of the DOJ top people into the Manhattan DA's office to run things. They don't even have a case against me. It's not even a case. Everyone says...
I want to stop right here. He's absolutely right about Manhattan. That is a joke. But it does, the poker teller, he's worried more about Fulton County than anything else. Because, you know, the federal laws are going to get thrown out. McDonnell doctrine. And it's just going to get thrown out. But Fulton County is not going to get thrown out. And it's going to be on TV. And he's going to be the star of a TV show of which he cannot speak. It's going to kill him. Really. That's what is the real challenge here. Cut number 44.
If you're elected president again, what's your number one priority? When you ran last time, you said, I will build a wall. This time, your bottom line top promise to the country.
So you can do numerous things at the same time.
Of course.
But let's say number one is a border and taking hundreds of thousands of criminals that have been allowed into our country and getting them out and bringing them back to their country, Guatemala. By the way, not only the four countries that we think of as neighbors, all over the world. Last month, we had 149 countries represented. Think of it. We had 149 countries represented, Tucker, from places that many people never even heard of, coming into our country. And they're coming in from mental institutions, and they're coming in from prisons. They're emptying out their prisons all over South America. They're emptying out their mental institutions. Terrorists are pouring into our country. We have no idea. I had the strongest border in the history of our country, and I built almost 500 miles of wall. You know, they like to say, oh, was it less? No. I built 500 miles. In fact, if you check with the authorities on the border, we built almost 500 miles of wall, and I had another 200 that I was going to build. You know, it's like water. It seeks. And we're going to build another 200. We built it. It was all set to go. All they had to do was install it. It would have taken 3 weeks. And that's when I found out. I said, I think these people actually want open borders. The first thing I would do would be I would seal up the border good and tight, except for people that want to come in legally.
All right. So you see, debates can be fine if people get to engage. The Vivek debate, nobody got to engage. Debate is walking around like a pincushion this morning, but he probably did well. But the guy who won last night was Ron DeSantis and Donald Trump. Because they both established they're the force majeures. They are the hurricanes in this race. And I'm coming back for hour two. Stay tuned.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. No matter what you saw last night, I saw a Vivek debate, one that's going to go on and on for a long time because charisma plus some vulnerabilities equals let's throw our spears that way. And that's what happened last night. We'll talk about it coming up throughout today's show. Your phone calls are welcome here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
You won't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
The rich men north of Richmond. I did not think, Mary Katharine Ham, guest extraordinaire, that a song about Guy Benson would be number one in America. What do you think?
I didn't realize it was number one on the charts. I knew about the song, of course, but I didn't know it was number one on the charts until I heard them.
It got Guy Benson written all over it. Rich men north of Richmond. That's Guy Benson's ballad. We should tattoo that on his forehead. I'm a rich man north of Richmond. Mary Katharine,
you know, Guy can wear it proudly.
There is no reason in the world for anyone to go to Milwaukee who's not interviewing a candidate. But then it hit me. Mary Katharine went because she told the wonderful Mr. Ham, "Oh, honey, I've got to go. It's business. You take care of the kids for 3 nights." Is that what happened?
Hey, you know, the job comes with perks, Hugh. Who am I to say no to them? It's important for me to be here where the people are, okay? In this hotel room by myself.
And in the spin room, I was watching that madcap menagerie last night thinking to myself, thank God, you know, I got a call from Phil Boyd. Do we need to go to Milwaukee? I said, God, no, we don't need to go to Milwaukee. There's no reason. What did you make of the debate last night, Mary Katharine? You're actually sane.
I actually enjoyed the debate. There were plenty of moments where I thought it was refreshing that we were talking about policy, that people were sort of getting into some real divisions in the GOP on issues like Ukraine. I actually enjoyed the conversation about abortion, that just sort of like balanced the idea of federalism with morality and had this dispute. I also enjoyed that we went 51 minutes before we talked about indictment news or Trump, and that was nice for me. Now, in the end, I don't think the ball moved very much because no one really made a giant splash. And I guess Vivek Ramaswamy, but in the wrong way, probably. But you have to make a giant splash. You really have to stand out if you've got a 30-point gap. And that's the issue.
So let's talk about that last point, Vivek. It's the Vivek debate. All right? It's the first debate. Ron DeSantis has, you know football. Ron DeSantis has a series of downs called for the first debate. He executed. He got a first down. That's all he wanted to do was come out, got a first down. Vivek has got a little bit of momentum, and he walks out there. But I actually think, did you see the movie Gladiator 800 times like every other person your age?
I did, yes.
Okay, so at the end, what does the bad guy do to the gladiator?
He gives him the thumbs down?
No, he puts the knife in his stomach, and nobody sees
it. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay, here's that moment. Can we play cut number, cut number 28. This is the moment.
I wish you well in your future career on the boards of Lockheed and Raytheon.
You know, I'm not on but the fact of the matter, and Raytheon, and you know, you
Boeing came off of it, but you've been pushing this lie. You've been pushing this lie all week, Nikki.
You want to go and defund Israel? You want to
Okay, let me address that. I'm glad you brought that up.
Go and give
I'm going to address each of those right now. This is the false lies of a professional politician. There you have it.
So you the reality make America is, less safe. You have no foreign policy experience, and it shows.
And you know what?
Do not make mom mad. All right, that's it. Do not make a military mom spouse whose husband is deployed mad for the third time.
Yeah.
That is the moment of the debate. And I think that's going to be the one that makes it into any account of campaign 2024.
Yeah, no, I think that was huge. And the moment she said it, especially, and it shows, and she repeated it twice, she took her moment. That is her bread and butter. She understands these issues. She showed she understands these issues. And she's just calling out this guy who really is out of his depth on this. I thought another defining moment was and it was in the first half of the debate, which is good for Ron DeSantis because that's when most people are watching. When he short-circuited a hand-raising question about climate change, that was great. He was very assertive. He basically said, look, we are the GOP. We can talk about the intricacies and the trade-offs of energy. We don't have to believe this like a religion. That's what that felt like to me. And I enjoyed the conversation that we had after that. And he went, as he did with every answer, to exactly what he has done on the ground, a record dealing with disasters in the state of Florida. I did it. Look at this. And he was relentless in that. And that was what he needed to do to some extent.
Yeah. You know, you're a football person. The Browns have Nick Chubb, greatest running back in the NFL. And the Browns fans are always saying, run the ball. All right, that's all they ever say on Twitter during a Browns game is run the ball. Give the ball to Chubb. Give the ball to Chubb. When DeSantis got the ball, he went off tackle through the gap every time. It was just exactly what he needed to do. Now, we got a lot of talking heads out there talking about how he didn't, you know, win the night because Vivek got the most attention. I'm just not with that, Mary Catherine. I think Ron DeSantis did exactly what he wanted to do, as did Mike Pence, as did Nikki Haley. Vivek did not do what he wanted to do. He kept the people who were in love with him, in love with him. But did he add anyone new? Fetching Mrs. Hewitt, not dumb about politics, not obsessed with it like me, says, boy, he's awfully cute. And I think that is actually kind of what a lot of people said. Oh, he's awfully cute. But you know what? Cute, you don't want cute on 9/11, do you?
No, and yeah, and he's too cute by half pretty often, which is the problem with him. No, I look, attention matters in this sort of attention economy and in this race, but it also doesn't matter that much if ultimately you're not going to prosecute a case against Trump, who is the front runner. And he's not doing that. He called him the best president of the 21st century. It's like, why are you running against him? That would be my question for you. But DeSantis did draw distinctions, and it did, you know, it was interesting and weird to see no one except for Christie go really hard on Trump in his absence. But it was nice to hear about results. It was nice to hear about policy. It was nice to hear about things that people did. And DeSantis really concentrated on that. And I think he did himself so good. The question is, the gap is so large. How do you pull people to you in big enough numbers? And I'm not sure last night did it.
Let me play for you. Gatling gun Chris Christie was loaded, all right? And he went off. And so let's play a couple of Chris Christie clips for you. Cut number 11.
I've had enough already tonight of a guy who sounds like ChatGPT standing up here. And the last person in one of these debates, Brett, who stood in the middle of the stage and said, what's a skinny guy with an odd last name doing up here, was Barack Obama, and I'm afraid we're dealing with the same type of amateur standing in stage tonight.
Ooh. All right, let's go to cut number 18. I'll go back to Hammer after that. Cut 18.
Behavior and illegal behavior, Chris, and you as a prosecutor should know better.
Yeah, you know what? I know a lot better.
There's a difference between bad behavior.
And I know a lot better than you do. You've never done it like you've never done anything to try to advance the interests of this government except to put yourself forward as a candidate tonight. And here's the thing. We've stood up for law and order. I did it as U.S. attorney. I did it as governor. And I am not going to bow to anyone when we have a president of the United States who disrespects the Constitution.
Okay, so I think Chris Christie came with a plan. It had take out Vivek on his card. Everyone was expecting that he was going to go after Donald Trump. He did a little bit. Not one word about DeSantis. He went after Vivek last night because Vivek is the guy who he's fighting in New Hampshire where Chris Christie intends to come through. Now, if I were a network, I would sign Chris Christie for a Sunday night, a nighttime primetime show. He's clearly the best at this thing. Do you agree with me on that?
Totally agree.
Yeah, he's just the best. And he's the funniest. And he is not rehearsed. And he just, does it matter in New Hampshire? Are there enough free electrons spinning around in New Hampshire that he can actually win?
In the flinty people of New Hampshire, I don't know if he can win, but I think he can show well. He sort of willed himself into that position to be able to do that with the sheer force of his ability to talk, right? And it's real. And I enjoy watching him. I actually think he sort of led the debate at times last night in that he would make attacks and then everyone would pile on. I will pat myself on the back a little bit because I said yesterday to Guy Benson that I think he might go after Vivek because A, Vivek has had momentum going into last night, and B, I think Chris Christie is annoyed by the type of candidate that Vivek Ramaswamy is, and he loves...
It's Vivek, by the way. It rhymes with cake. It's Vivek. I got trained by the Vivekian people. It's Vivek, rhymes with cake. But I can't believe you're cavorting with the rich man north of Richmond. If you see that rich man north of Richmond, well, you've just got to get away from him because there's a song about Guy Benson. The Ballad of Guy Benson is out there right now. Mary
I'm
Catherine,
just
going
to learn to play the banjo so that I can follow him around.
Rich man north of Richmond, Guy Benson, and Mary Catherine Ham. Go to the Getting Hammered podcast. I cannot wait to listen to it. Don't go anywhere, America. More coming up on today's Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you in part by the American Legislative Exchange Council. Visit ALEC.org for more info.
living in the new world with an old soul. These rich men north of Richmond, Lord knows it all, just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think, wanna know what you do, and they don't think you know, but I know that you do, 'cause your dollar ain't this, and it's taxed to no end.
Guy Benson Ballad, the Ballad of Guy Benson, otherwise known as Richmond North of Richmond.
Wish politicians look out for miners and not just miners.
I'm Hugh Hewitt. Thank you for watching. Lord, we got, if you're one of the Richmond North of Richmond, I doubt you'll give a dollar to Food for the Poor. Now, they have sponsored my program for years. The Fetching Mrs. Hewitt and I write them large checks, and we do that because we believe and love the work that they do with the poorest of the poor, the lost and the least. If you don't know about Food for the Poor, it began as a small group of priests and nuns feeding people. Then it grew into a non-denominational. I believe it's now Protestant run, but I'm not sure. I don't care. I really don't care who is doing service to the lost and the least. But we need your help. And let me tell you what's happened. We normally, this audience is normally as generous as any audience in the world. And it is generous. But a lot of you have sent money to Maui, and I understand why. There are a lot of groups that have sprung up. And I'm here to tell you, new groups do not do well when it comes to the tip of the spear. They're wonderful and emotional, and I love that there are a lot of new groups that sprang up to help the people of Maui, especially the families who lost children. And it's tragic what happened there. But there's a tragedy underway in Haiti right now, and you don't see it on the news because there aren't any cameras and there's not any electricity. But Food for the Poor knows what's going on. And they're, run the tape of the boxes, would you, Harley? We have, this is what they do with your money, all right? This is not rocket science. What do people need when disaster strikes, as is happening in Haiti right now? It's just a tropical storm, but just a tropical storm in Hawaii is like a Category 3 in America. Because there is no infrastructure. There are no police. There is no law and order. There is no way to get food and tarps and the money that they need and the personal hygiene products, all right? That's all in those boxes, if you're watching on the Salem News Channel. A box costs $100. A few of you came in yesterday. Now, a lot of you have given money to Maui initiatives, and that's great, and God love you. You're trying to help the lost and the least. But please don't forget the people who don't have a first world infrastructure. They're not very competent on Maui, and there's going to be an accounting on Maui, and a lot of people will lose their jobs, and you can't bring the dead back. And people are already, it's a rich place. Maui, where I've spent a lot, is not got all rich people, but it's a rich place. Haiti has nothing. So please consider Food for the Poor. I let them sponsor this program, and I participate in this, because they do what they say they're going to do. And God bless them, and God bless you for helping. Gary in Chicago, what did you think last night?
Yeah, you. I narrowed it down to three, Ramaswamy, DeSantis, and Haley. But I think that Ramaswamy and DeSantis, they may jeopardize the support for Ukraine. And so I would love to see Haley get more traction. And if she doesn't become the nominee, I'd like to see her on the ticket, get her ready for 2028. I think she's top-notch. I would love to see her win.
Well, there are three tickets out of Iowa, they say, and two tickets out of New Hampshire. Sometimes there are three. And I think you name the three are getting tickets, not named Trump. I just don't know what's going to happen with the former president. Right? He gave a terrific interview to Donald Trump, to Tucker last night. I mean, it was absolutely first-rate. First-rate. Absolutely first-rate. But he is going to be in trial, and they're going to move that trial along in Georgia, and it's going to be years till it's worked out. And I love the guy as an interview. I do not like the guy as a candidate, because you're going to be in a courtroom in Atlanta, right? I don't know how it works. I would like Tucker to have asked. Tucker did a very fine interview, equal of any other interview in America, and the counter programming doesn't really work because you don't have to watch one or the other. You can watch both, and that's what I've been doing. But what'd you make of the president last night, former president, with Tucker?
I think you're. I thought he was a little lower key than usual. But it was definitely typical Trump.
And, he's funny. You know,
Trucker
he's
does a good job. Yeah,
he's a funny guy, and Tucker's a pro. Like, but I think Chris Christie. If I'm any network executive in America, I'm trying to get Chris Christie this morning to say, look, Governor, give this stuff up. Let's put you on the air every night at 7, and we'll pay you like a lot of money. I'd watch that show every night. I would. I'd watch that show every night. Smart guy. Don't go anywhere, America, except to relieffactor.com. I'm in the relieffactor.com studio. They sponsor this studio. You saw the studio last night on the Salem News Channel. I'm blinking a lot because 4 hours of sleep is not a lot to work with. But relieffactor.com does not help you go to bed. It's not melatonin. It's not Ambien. It is not a addictive substance. It's natural supplements that assist your body's anti-inflammatory system. So I don't actually think I'm going to trundle today. I think I'm going to go back to bed, actually. The 4 hours is fine when you're Mary Katharine Ham's age. It's a vacation for her. She got all those kids at home. And so I really don't think she needed to go to Milwaukee. And she just went because she, you know, Mrs. Mary Katherine and Mr. Mary Katherine Ham has the kids, and she gets it to be in a hotel room by herself. And as far as I know, every mom in America would love to be in a hotel room by herself for 3 nights. So I just believe for a fact she didn't need to be there. But relieffactor.com keeps me going on the highways and byways. So maybe this afternoon I'll go out and trundle. And if I do it, it's because of relieffactor.com. Go. 1995. Get you started.
they all just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think, wanna know what you do.
Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Governor Doug Burgum was on the stage last night. He joins me now. Good morning, Governor. How are you?
Good morning, Hugh. Great to be with you.
Now, I have got my wife's best friend has torn two Achilles tendons playing basketball. And I know you did that two nights ago. And the first thing I want to know, and the most important thing, is your wife mad at you for doing that?
She was very understanding, I'd say, beyond human expectation. She knows I love playing, and she didn't even give me that glance of, hey, I told you so. Maybe this wasn't a great idea right before this debate.
Well, Governor, I got to ask you, you're my age. What in the world are you doing playing basketball? It's like that is not the game for people our age. I mean, we can go out and golf, run, swim, do all, but you're jumping up and down. What in the world are you doing?
Well, Hugh, I've played basketball my whole life, and it's a great way to unwind. And my son, my 30-year-old son was there, and we had some gym space at a local university that has a great basketball program. I thought it would be kind of historic to, you know, shoot around there. And
you're definitely the first guy with a torn Achilles tendon in a Republican presidential debate. I got to tell you that. Governor, I want to ask you about, yeah, everyone's got a million debate stories. I've moderated four of those things, and I got 20 stories out of each of them. So I want to know, first of all, it's kind of a rodeo, but it's not your first rodeo. You're from North Dakota, after all. What'd you think of the whole Lollapalooza debate stuff?
Well, I'd say, Hugh, honest assessment, it took me through the first 30-minute segment to figure out that no one was going to follow any of the rules that we've been told ahead of time. So it was, you know, barely get a word in edgewise, but then we fought our way back, and staying with a sports analogy, I felt like we won the fourth quarter. We finally got into some substance. There was a lot of noise, and I don't think enough signal for the American public, for the voters that are trying to decide. And also, we've got these huge issues. China is a massive issue. We've got, you know, we're in a cold war with China, and we're in this war with Russia. And I just felt we didn't spend enough time on that. And of course, as you know, I feel these things are completely and totally tied to both our economy and the Biden energy policies, which are 180 degrees in the wrong direction.
Now, Governor, you got to be honest with me here and tell me what you think of Vivek, because I call it the Vivek debate. He got 1,000 spears in him, but he basically won the attention game. And there are two games. Do you persuade people to support you for president in Iowa and New Hampshire? And do you win the attention game and get small donors? Vivek got a lot of attention, but you've done what he did. You succeeded in business far beyond what he did. You built this company, which nobody knows about because they didn't have any time to do bio last night. What are you thinking about when you watch all the attention to Vivek and you're standing over on the other end saying, well, I did all that, and then I run a state for 7 years?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just interesting because I think the, you know, as someone that came from the outside into government, I think there's real benefit because coming in as an outsider, particularly with the background I had, which actually had to do with business operations and with, you know, the business processes that allow you to serve customers better with less inputs. And I'm saying that because that's what government does. I mean, we said in North Dakota, we're going to treat the taxpayers like customers. And we came in and we took $1.7 billion out of a $6 billion budget, you know, 27% cut, and all the trains ran on time. So there's business guys, and then there's business guys that have been in other business, whether it's, you know, real estate or biotech. It's not the same as someone who's, you know, all of our customers were small business, all of our partners were small businesses. And then at the end, I was at a chance to run really large businesses at scale. And there's just so much of that that's directly applicable to what's going on. And so when I, you know, when I hear someone say, hey, they're going to cut the Department of Education, which I would too, but that's 4,000 out of 2 million employees. It's the real win is taking 20% out of every job. It's not shooting a department in the head. It's going in and saying the whole thing is inefficient. I mean, I met some guys again last night. And I said, you know, I was being interviewed in the spin room, and I said, how many apps do you think you have in your phone? And, you know, most people would say 150 or more. I said, do you have any apps from the federal government? And they're all like, no, I don't. I mean, so it's like there's just the way that people are interacting and using technology today with a supercomputer in their pocket. They don't even think, like, why am I not relating to government this way?
So do you know what I can't understand, Governor? I'm going to put a bug in your ear. We have allegedly a teacher's crisis in America. We allegedly have a teacher. We don't have enough teachers. They can't find jobs. Districts are scrambling. Why isn't the Department of Education running one website that says, here's every vacancy in America, here's what the class is, here's what you'll be paid, and here are the coaching duties you can take on. Will you call this person and get your application in? Why do we not have that? This is like 2024.
Exactly, Hugh, exactly. And this is the kind of thing where if you, coming from the private sector where I was working, and then coming into government, these kinds of opportunities are laying on the ground. This is like fruit that's fallen off the tree. You can attack in any direction with 100 ideas like this that cost very little but actually make government more efficient. So you're spot on.
Now, do you mind if I quiz you a little bit? Because we didn't get to the commander-in-chief test last night. Okay, the commander-in-chief test, which Chairman Mike Gallagher of the Select Committee on China says, this is the most important thing about debates, which is, do you learn anything about how someone will react on 9/11? W was magnificent on 9/11. He was even better when we meet in the middle moment of our grief at the National Cathedral. There are times that you need the commander-in-chief to go into the situation room, bark at people, get down to six. I'm reading a biography of Nimitz, and he really was a commander-in-chief of the fleet at full tide. So I'd like to know whether you can do this. And it's not intended to ambush you. I'd just like to know if you're up to speed on this stuff. Is it okay with you?
Sure.
Why did we collapse in Kabul? What went wrong in the last... We're 2 years ago, greatest foreign policy fiasco of my lifetime occurred, and that includes Vietnam in Kabul. What happened there in your view?
Well, I think one thing was a failure of intelligence because, you know, as much as... You know, Biden was just saying, hey, we've got to get out of here, and I've got a date in mind, which is the 20th anniversary of 9/11, and I think I'm going to win some political points by getting out by that time. You know, I'm sure he had some people that told him, hey, if you do this, you know, the Taliban is going to just stay in the country. They're not going to come in. You know, Bagram Air Force Base will be fine. I mean, it was a massive, massive failure, and had to be a whole series of people, but him in particular. And this one offends me personally. We were getting ready for the 20th anniversary of 9/11 as the commander-in-chief of the North Dakota National Guard. We had lost 29 lives during the War on Terror. So we had invited all the Gold Star mothers to come to an event that was coming up. So 2 weeks before that, then Biden's doing this, you know, atrocious withdrawal, costing us tens of billions of dollars, opening up the way for China to come in like the next week and start taking over rare earth mineral development in Afghanistan to further, you know, build themselves as the, you know, the EV battery superpower of the world that Biden wants to buy all the batteries for our EVs that we're subsidizing from. And then what do you say? These Gold Star mothers are like, look, we thought that our son died for a cause that mattered. That's what their belief was. Biden shattered that. It is unforgivable what he did to all of those families. And this is just one little lens of that in our small state where these North Dakota National Guard troops on active duty, you know, died in Afghanistan. And then he does this. I mean, it's just unthinkable to me.
Governor, have you had a chance? I don't know. You're on the road a lot. I don't know if you have a chance to read, but if you can read one book, I hope it's this one, Kabul by Jerry Dunleavy and James Hassan. Have you heard about it yet?
I haven't, but I'll write it down right now.
Yeah, Kabul, it's on bestseller list. It just came out 2 weeks ago, and it is the definitive account of the fiasco that is Joe Biden's. I mean, the reason he cannot be president again is because he simply, as Robert Gates said, he hadn't been right in 50 years on any major issue of foreign affairs. Let me ask you about the suicide problem. Are you familiar with the fact that 30,000 vets of the 20-year war have taken their own life upon the return to the United States? What is going on there, and what would you do as the commander-in-chief to stop that?
Well, this is something we've put a huge amount of attention in North Dakota, but I know nationally, I mean, to get to the number you're talking about, I think it tracks, you know, sadly, today is Thursday. There'll be another 22 veterans that complete suicide today. You know, that's what sort of the running tally is. And this has to be a full on effort. I mean, we have a mental health crisis in America. We spend $4 trillion on health care, but it's not really health care. We spend it on sick care primarily, and most of that, you know, the last 6 months, end of life. And we're not doing anything on the preventative side, and we really don't treat mental or behavioral health sometimes as a health issue. It's like, you know, suck it up, you're going to be fine kind of approach. And we just have to completely flip it where we're, you know, it's much more effective to spend the dollars upstream on prevention and education than it is spending it when we've got people in acute crises on the back end. You know, you won't be able to build enough behavioral health hospitals, but we've got to move those dollars upstream. And part of it then again is community awareness. It's leadership in North Dakota National Guard, making sure that everybody understands the signals, and then also changing the stigma. And this is something the First Lady, who's she struggled with addiction for over two decades, has been in recovery, and now as First Lady of North Dakota has been courageous in sharing her story of addiction and recovery, because we have to normalize the conversation. If you think that, you know, mental health, behavioral health, and addiction, which are often co-occurring, and they're co-occurring almost 100% among homeless, that if people want to hide in the closet about the fact that they're dealing with the disease of addiction, which is a brain disease, we know that now, then they don't get treatment. You know, if someone's got diabetes, they get treated. If they have cancer, you get treated. If someone's got a mental or behavioral health issue, and then they hide it even from their family members. And so if the stigma is so high, we can't even treat it. So across the board, we need a different approach, and it's related. You know, some of this is 70% of the overdose deaths under Biden. Biden, we've had four Vietnams worth of deaths that have occurred just in the time that Biden's been in office of overdoses in this country, and but 70% of those were fentanyl poisoning. So some of those aren't overdoses the way we think about an addict that was, you know, dealing with addiction, that was trying to get treatment, and then, you know, couldn't get over the hump. Some of this is the people that, you know, they buy one Percocet on the street for $30 and it's got fentanyl in it.
I know of someone who did that. I know a grieving family from that. One pill. Governor, now we've spent more time talking, and I want to keep you after the break to land this plane. So if the music comes up, don't go anywhere. Give me five more minutes. Neither of these issues came up last night. The collapse in Afghanistan and the suicide among veterans. Neither of them came up. That is a feature, not a bug, of presidential debates. How would you fix presidential debates? Because Brett and Martha are the best. They're the equal of anyone. But there isn't any time or seriousness.
No, there's none. And that's why I said earlier, it's, you know, a lot of noise and not much signal. And I think I'm sad for the American public, because I feel like in some cases, I don't know why we call them a debate. I mean, call it political theater. Call it what it is, but these are not serious policy discussions.
I will come right back. I'm going to spend five more minutes with the governor off the air, and I'll play it later in the show. Don't go anywhere, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. So, Governor Burgum, we'll play this later in the show. My last question is, I don't know what the rules are for round two. Do you know if you have qualified for round two?
We've qualified for everything. There was 50,000 donors. There was above a certain polling threshold in primary states, and then also a national poll threshold number. And we've qualified for everything, but we need to get above 3% in a national poll.
And do you think you'll make that?
Yeah, absolutely, we will.
All right. Now, if that is the case, how would you like the format to change? For example, should there be an audience in the room? Should there be one moderator as opposed to two? Should there be three instead of two? How would you, Doug Burgum, as a businessman and executive, and your credentials are stellar, but you're not going to survive three rounds with those rules?
No, I'm certainly intending on surviving, but I think that, you know, I'm focused more on the voters, more on the American public. I mean, they need to actually have an opportunity to hear the kinds of questions that you're asking, Hugh. I mean, that your commander chief questions and others. And as you noted, I mean, I got more time to cover those two topics than the entire eight of us did last night. So I think the live audience, again, when you're just chasing cable ratings, then, you know, live audience maybe adds something to that. But, of course, then you have all the issues of people stacking the audience, doing different things. I think it was difficult sometimes for people in the audience, and sometimes I think for the candidates on the stage to be even able to hear when the moderators were asking questions over the top of trying to keep things going when people are yelling. So that, you know, that, again, is all, you know, political theater and maybe interesting, but it's not, not helping advance anybody's understanding of the key issues.
You know, so my last question, do you think we're serious about electing the best person to be president of the United States? Are we, as a country, I'm not talking about Fox News, I'm not talking about radio and television or the spin room. As a country, are we serious about this?
I would have to say that there's been a misconception about what it takes to actually do the job. You understand it. You saw it under President Nixon, President Reagan. You've been there. You've been in the room. You understand what it takes to do that. And I think that we're, you know, some of these things are not just popularity contests. We've, you know, moved in this era of celebrity presidents, and there is a disconnect from an understanding or a process. And I think, you know, neither party has got a process which is delivering. And all you have to say is, look, if you have a country of 340 million people, and then I'll call it, say, 8 people applied or 12 people applied for the job. When I was in the private sector, if we had the most important job in a company, like if I was chairman of the board and we're hiring a CEO, and we had, you know, a dozen people applied and some of them weren't qualified, we'd repost. We'd be like, whoa, did we forget to advertise in the right places? You know, we should have a bigger pool. So I think there's a candidate quality and a candidate size pool where people have this, the narratives is like, oh, this is a really crowded field, but oh my goodness, this is the most important job in the world. And you're, you know, when I'm standing up there last night, I'm like, absolutely, I belong on this stage, and we're going to keep fighting to make sure we win this job.
Governor, keep coming back. I appreciate the time this morning, and I hope the injury heals. Put down the basketball, Governor, because you don't want the second one to go. Great to have you. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you, Hugh.
Okay, I want you to come out with Richmond north of Richmond. Welcome back, America. Didn't realize. I didn't see it coming. Byron York joins me. Byron, did you see a song about Guy Benson coming as the intro to the debate last night?
You know, I will say that a lot of my colleagues in the press were surprised when Martha McCallum made the first question about this song, and I thought it worked very, very well. I thought it
was, so did I, because it's kind of fun.
It was a good and clever idea. And it was a really fresh way to open up a debate. And I Ron DeSantis took the answer and did well with it. So I thought it was actually a great open to the debate.
Let's pause on that. I tweeted out after that leadoff home run by Ron DeSantis. And he's a baseball player. That's why I use the analogy. They served him a fat one, and he was smart. It's not canned because he used the name of the song in the answer. And it leads me to my assessment, and I want to get yours. Ron DeSantis, it's the first quarter of a long season, and he executed the plays that he had scheduled to call, and he did it well. He made no mistakes, and he emerged as he was in second place before the debate behind Donald Trump. Do you agree with my assessment of Ron DeSantis' performance last night? No mistakes, execute 3 running plays, first down.
Not entirely. I don't think he did as well as you're saying. He did do well with that first answer. And he had some other good areas as well. You know, when they asked for a show of hands answer on climate change, and he just grabbed it. He said, look, we don't need to show our hands. We're not in class. And then he just took the answer. On the other hand, I think overall it was really a chance for him to break out of the field. And I don't think he actually did. He had a terrible moment when Brett Baer asked whether they would each candidate would continue to support President Trump if Trump were convicted in a court of law. The candidates on stage right began to raise their hands. DeSantis actually glances over at them before sort of tentatively raising his own hand. So I think that he wanted to dominate. I think that, you know, DeSantis was saying before the debate that he expected to be the target of most of the attacks, and that just didn't happen. He was not the clear leader in the onstage field.
You see, and I view the campaign as like as an NFL game, and if you run your first set of plays and you get a first down, I'm fine with it. The person I'm most confused about, and I'll say this, you can watch that debate and think Vivek Ramaswamy did great, and you can watch that debate and think Komodas put the knife in Maximus at the end there. When Nikki, do not make Nikki Haley mad. Do not make a mom mad. Do not make a military spouse mad. Let me play you my... This is the clip, and maybe you disagree with me, but this is the clip that matters the most from that debate last night. It is, you know, they've got very great restrictions at Fox News on how much audio we've used, so I've got to get the right one. Cut number 28.
You know, Nikki, I wish you well in your future career on the boards of Lockheed and Raytheon.
You know, I'm not on but the fact of the matter, and you know,
Boeing
you
came off of it, but you've been pushing this lie. You've been pushing this lie all week, Nikki.
You want to go and defund Israel? This, you want to
okay, let me address that.
China.
I'm glad you brought
you
that up.
Go and give you
I'm going to address
Russia?
Each of those right now.
You
this is the false lies of a professional politician. There you have it.
So the reality is, America less safe. You have no foreign policy experience, and it shows.
And you know what?
It shows.
All right, best moment of the debate, the takeaway moment. What'd you make of it?
Yeah, I agree. Nikki Haley actually did very well. She did well on a lot of other issues, including abortion. I think she made good use of this resume she has, which is she's been a governor and she's been the United Nations ambassador. So, you know, not that many people who've been a governor also have foreign policy experience. So she's got an advantage there. Did well in the debate, and actually the Ramaswamy thing was the really the most interesting part of the debate. I remember, was it last week maybe, on Candidate Casino, on Special Report, our question was, you know, which candidate, you know, could break out and make a big impression in this debate. And yours truly said Vivek Ramaswamy, because, I mean, I've watched him enough to know that when people see him, especially on first impression, they're going to be kind of amazed at what a performer he is. Last night he was more, as they say, polarizing than maybe even I thought he would be. You know, he was just absolutely a jerk on a couple of times.
Bingo.
He said he was the only person on stage who wasn't bought and paid for.
Nasty does not work with a lot of our party. I mean,
exactly.
It just
and
doesn't...
we should say that Nikki Haley is not on the board of Raytheon. What was the other one? The two defense contractors.
Yeah, so, Lockheed and Raytheon. She has been on the board of Boeing, and she got off the board of Boeing when she decided to run for president. But I got to tell you, you did make that bet, and he did have the most attention. I call it the Vivek debate. But I'm sticking with, I had my $30 on Ron DeSantis because I do believe it's a marathon, not a sprint. And he executed. So did Mike Pence. But more coming up. Byron, I'll look for you this week on Special Report and your assessment in the Washington Examiner this morning. Thanks for joining me this morning. Hour number three coming up, America. Don't go anywhere except right here. Keep it on the Hugh Hewitt Show.
Portions of the Hugh Hewitt Show are brought to you by Food for the Poor.
This hour of Hugh Hewitt starts right now on Salem News Channel.
Good morning, America. No matter what you saw last night, I saw a Vivek debate, one that's going to go on and on for a long time because charisma plus some vulnerabilities equals let's throw our spears that way. And that's what happened last night. We'll talk about it coming up throughout today's show. Your phone calls are welcome here on The Hugh Hewitt Show.
Don't want to miss a minute. This hour of Hugh Hewitt is on Salem News Channel.
just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think, wanna know what you do. And they don't think you know, but I know that you do. Cause your dollar ain't dish, and it's taxed to no end. Cause the rich men, cause the rich men.
Morning Glory America. As you know, Richmond North of Richmond is all about Guy Benson. Josh Kraushaar joins me now. What do you think about opening the debate with the ballad of Guy Benson, Josh?
Yeah, Hugh, I thought that was a smart play for Brett and Martha because, look, that is the economic frustrations and anxieties that so many Americans feel. And that was a great way to, you know, literally be an entree into the economic portion of the debate where, boy, those sparks, the sparks were flying at the debate here in Milwaukee from there.
Okay, let's get your scorecard. I've given the audience mine already. You don't need to hear mine before we hear yours. Winners, losers, takeaways.
Yeah, look, I think the big my big question, Hugh, going in is, you know, I think there are three Republicans who have the capability of winning both the traditional conservative vote and can also are well liked by even more MAGA-oriented Republican voters, and that's DeSantis, Haley, and Tim Scott. And of those three, to me, only Haley had a standout performance. She showcased a command on foreign policy going after you. You know, that those exchanges against Vivek Ramaswamy are going to be played over and over again. And that's the divide, by the way, Hugh, within the party on foreign policy. That is sort of the isolationism versus the traditional Reaganite foreign policy. And Haley took the Reagan position, and I think that's a good place to be in. But she also was a great debater. She had a command of the issues. She wasn't even afraid to subtly tweak Trump, which is necessary if you're going to ultimately defeat the front runner in this race. So, look, I don't know if this is going to, you know, a lot of times these days, the mood of the party is a lot different than where it was 8 years ago. But Haley did as good as you could possibly imagine for someone who still has that upside potential in this Republican primary.
Okay, I'll tell you what I've told everyone thus far, Josh, and I don't expect you to have heard it in your hotel room in Milwaukee. I think Ron DeSantis entered the game like an NFL coach with a series of plays drawn up that he wanted to get done. And he got it done. So he got his first down. He moved on. It's a marathon, not a sprint. All the cliches apply. I agree with you. Nikki Haley had the breakout moment. I want to play for you the one cut that if it, you know, there's this cut of Chris Christie destroying Marco Rubio from 2016, which will live in infamy forever. This is the only cut that I think matters last night. The one cut, cut number 28.
You know, Nikki, I wish you well in your future career on the boards of Lockheed and Raytheon.
You know, I'm not on but the fact of the matter, and you know,
Boeing
you
came off of it, but you've been pushing this lie.
Stage,
you've been pushing this lie all week, Nikki.
You want to go and defund Israel? This, you want to
okay, let me address that. I'm glad you brought that up.
Go and give
I'm
going to
address
Russia.
Each of those right now.
You
this is the false lies of a
America
professional politician. There you have it.
So you the reality make America less safe. You have no foreign policy experience, and it shows.
And you know what?
It shows.
It shows. What'd you think of that exchange? Because, by the way, Vivek was nasty there. I don't think nasty ever works unless you're Donald Trump.
Yeah, that was not his finest moment at the debate. And look, I think he is appealing. But with Donald Trump off the stage, you know, Vivek Ramaswamy was essentially running as the Trump protege. He was appealing to many of the same populist issues, and he's had some success on the campaign trail doing that. I don't know how that's the formula to defeating Donald Trump in this primary, but it certainly has gotten him momentum in the race. But look, on that exchange, Haley was pretty spot on that she showcased his lack of depth on foreign policy, and she kind of, even before that exchange, she really went into the consequences of what would happen if we stopped helping Ukraine and pulling out funding from Ukraine, as Ramaswamy was the one Republican to advocate for on that stage. So look, she, on foreign policy, she certainly stood out and defended her view, which was the like dominant Republican worldview for so long.
Now, Josh, I want to give you a little insider take on the debate, is that the very best television is when a candidate is standing next to a candidate and they engage in sparky thing. That's great television. They had almost 25 million people watch last night. All right, so that's very big numbers. It tells us that increase in political interest is way off the chart. If you're standing next to someone, that's the person you want to get into a brawl with, because all of a sudden the other people on the stage go away. Did you notice that Nikki Haley did not stop talking? It was an exercise in domination. And she's got an advantage on that stage as the only woman, mom and spouse and military spouse. I thought she exploited that moment perfectly while making a substantive point. That's why I think it matters.
No, I think you're right, Hugh. And look, the fact that she is the one Republican woman on the stage, and I think that kind of mansplaining, if you will, from Vivek Ramaswamy is not going to play well with a lot of suburban women watching that debate on Fox last night.
Well, Vivek is married to a head and neck surgeon, so he knows how to deal with a very smart and intelligent woman, but he didn't do it last night. And there's a little bit of the momentum veiled cloak. Remember in Harry Potter, they had the cloak, that the invisibility cloak? Sure. Vivek thinks he has an invisibility cloak, but he doesn't. Everybody sees it. And so he did very well running up to this. He is a foreign policy rookie. Does that matter? Because I talked after the show, I did a Salem News Channel show, and I had two youngsters on. Julie Hartman, by youngsters, I mean young people, under 30. Doug Blair and Julie Hartman. They love Vivek. They love him. They're millennials. Do you think that's a divide in the party now?
Well, look, the younger Republicans have a much more isolationist view of foreign policy. And look, Vivek represents that faction of the party. So I don't know if he had a bad debate night necessarily. He had some moments. I think his talk about the education challenges in our country's education system was a good moment. I think he has a good personal story, but I think there's a limited appeal ultimately. There's a ceiling he's going to face. And I think fundamentally he's running as sort of, you know, he was the only guy on the stage that said he wanted to pardon Trump. And he really, you know, made a big deal about that. Well, ultimately, if you're going to win the nomination, you're going to have to run against Trump. So I get how he's having his moment. I don't see how he has a path. And it sounded like,
It's the Ted Cruz playbook. Senator Cruz played nice with Trump until he tried not to. It's too late. So I've seen this show before. Chris Christie, cut number 11, please. Chris Christie on Vivek.
I've had enough already tonight of a guy who sounds like ChatGPT standing up here. The last person in one of these debates, Brett, who stood in the middle of the stage and said, "What's a skinny guy with an odd last name doing up here?" was Barack Obama, and I'm afraid we're dealing with the same type of amateur standing on stage tonight.
Now, Josh, the reason I like that is because it's not scripted. He didn't know what Vivek was going to say. He just knew that he had to listen and respond accordingly. If I were a network exec, I'd go offer big bags of gold to Chris Christie to get out of the race and do my primetime show on cable. I really would. I just think he's fabulous at this stuff. What did you think Christie did for himself in New Hampshire last night? He's putting all of his chips on New Hampshire. That's what he's doing. He's not going to Iowa. He's living up north.
Yeah, so New Hampshire has a much more moderate Republican electorate. In fact, independents can vote in the New Hampshire primary. So his whole play throughout this campaign has been to camp out in New Hampshire and on cable news shows and appeal to the anti-Trump side of that New Hampshire Republican electorate. Now, that's no way of winning the nomination, but it certainly could kind of rehabilitate perhaps his political storyline if he does a strong performance in New Hampshire. I saw him doing some cable news interviews this morning, and he seemed to be going after Mike Pence, and he was trying to distinguish himself as even tougher than Pence when it came to January 6th. So I think, you know, it's pretty clear Christie's strategy. He's trying to win over what remains of this anti-Trump wing in the Republican Party. You know, it's only 15-20% of the vote, maybe a little more in New Hampshire. Not enough to win the nomination, but it could be enough for him to get some good headlines in one of the big early.
All right, I got to ask you very quickly about Senator Scott. Low-key does not work in debates. Low-key just doesn't work. You can't do that. Ace is going to be gone. Doug Burgum just told me he's going to hang on. Do you think Tim Scott made enough to hang on last night? I mean, I love Tim Scott, but there's nothing memorable, zero memorable about last night with Tim.
Yeah, I mean, he's got the money to hang on, so I certainly think he will. But look, if you're Nikki Haley, you've got to be awfully frustrated that, frankly, you like, Tim Scott's in the race, right? Because you appointed him to the Senate. I think she certainly, you know, at least at last night's debate, sort of was outshone him pretty significantly. And she has executive experience, you know, at the United Nations and serving two terms as governor of South Carolina with a whole lot of accomplishments. I mean, I gotta think that he's taking some of her vote. He's preventing, you know, well, look, I think we'll have more debates.
It's early. It's sure. early. I think I see your dilemma, but I just thought he missed some opportunities last night. Josh Kraushaar from Jewish Journal. Thank you, Josh. Follow him on the site, formerly known as Twitter, at Josh Kraushaar. Follow me to the next segment, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt.
living in the new world with an whole soul. These rich men, north of Richmond, Lord knows they all just wanna have total control. Wanna know what you think? Wanna know what
you know, I
gotta
send this bit to Guy. Guy Benson's one of my closest friends in the business. And I like to say, along with Dave Santrella, the CEO of Salem Media, that we mentored Guy. I love, this is the Ballad of Guy Benson. I know they might call it Rich Men North of Richmond, but it's actually the Ballad of Guy Benson. All right, what'd you think of last night? 1-800-520-1234. I got to tell you, 24 million is a big number. 24 million is a great audience. Nobody is better at this other than me, than Brett and Martha. And the reason I'm better at it, I'm a Republican, and I don't give a doggone, I almost said a bad word. I do not care what the liberal media thinks about me, and I do not care what news executives think about me who are not working for Salem. That's why I work for Salem. And Salem trusts me to do my own show. And I would not have spent 20 minutes on abortion. I would have opened with the fact that 2 years ago, 13 Americans were blown up at Abbey Gate because of the most incompetent president in our nation's modern history. I'd have gone at Biden with every question. Every single freaking question should be about the last 2.5 years that is a disaster in America. And we did not do that. That's my problem. All right, we did. And the Fox executives are happy, but it's not for Fox. It's not for ratings. It's not for commercial advertising. It's for Republican voters. And they want to know who will take the case against Joe Biden and prosecute it. And do you know what? Do you know what will happen with almost everyone on that stage? They will get slaughtered by the left-wing media machine in this country. Absolutely taken apart, shoulder and flank. They will be butchered. Because they're not ready for this. And you don't get ready and you don't persuade America about what is happening in this country unless you put in front. I can't even believe the Democratic Party is committed to expanding the Supreme Court to 14. It did not come up. Do you realize that's the end of rule of law in America if that happens? So if it's a Hugh Hewitt debate, I start with Kabul and I go to the Supreme Court. Then I come around to Joe Biden's infirmity and I ask about Hunter Biden and I talk about a two-tiered justice system. Did you hear any of that come up last night? I did not. So I'm a little bit frustrated, but they had 24 million people. And I think Brett and Martha are the equal of any big media corporation. But they are not partisan Republicans. And I am. All right? I am. And I am honest about it. I am a partisan Republican. We have to win this election. The country cannot endure an infirm, increasingly, obviously incompetent president. By incompetent, I mean not able to absorb the information. Ted in Venice, Florida. What do you think, Ted?
Good morning, Hugh. I just wanted to call and say I listen most every day. I couldn't disagree with you more. I'm a Republican from Venice, Florida. I thought Nikki Haley shrunk on that stage. Everybody was going after Vivek because he was the outsider, and he basically
No, Ted, that's not right. Nobody went after Vivek Ted, as a matter of fact, Vivek attacked everybody in his opening statement. I'm the only person not bought and sold by a super PAC. What do you expect them to say? You're right. I'm bought and sold by a super PAC. If you open hostilities, expect incoming.
Well, I admire him for doing that because.
Do you believe that?
Partially true.
Ted? No, get rid of Ted. Goodbye, Ted. No, it is freaking not true. That is a lie. Nobody on that stage. They're all good people. They're all Republicans. They have different points of view, and you might not like some of them. They are not bought and sold by Super PAC. That is a line from Sheldon, idiot Whitehouse of Rhode Island about dark money. That's why I did not like that. That is just a lie. And if Vivek ever comes back on this show, I'm going to say, Vivek, why do you do that? If you're a Republican, I'm not sure he is. Why do you do that? Why do you give the Democrats a talking point? Because this is a game. This is not a game. This is an election to be commander in chief. And we I don't care which one of them win or if Donald Trump wins, we have to win because we are getting killed in the world. All right. That's why we have to win. Oh, relief factor. You can tell I've had very little sleep because I'm a little trigger happy here this morning with callers, but do not tell me that Vivek got beat up on. No, when you say I'm bought and sold. ReliefFactor.com, they're a sponsor of this show, all right? They put this studio together. It's beautiful. I take it every day because it works. That's the key message here, is that ReliefFactor.com does work. Even when you're tired, I got to exercise sometime today. It's the only way, actually, to work off adrenaline. In the news business, you know that when you run down on sleep, you just got to go to bed, and then you've got to exercise, and then get back to normal. But you got to finish the day's job. And the day started yesterday at 5 p.m. and it went until about 12:30 a.m. And the day of after, you got to get exercise. And that's the day for ReliefFactor.com. Every day is the day for ReliefFactor.com. That's why I take it in the first hour and remind you in hours two and three. I may have another candidate. I may not. We'll find out. Stick around. I don't know who's holding up their end of the deal this morning. 1-800-520-1234. I won't yell at you if you don't say anything stupid. I will if you do. Stay tuned.
Lord, it's a damn shame what the world's gotten to for people like me, people like you. Wish I could just wake up and it not be true, but it is.
Oh, it is. All right, we got to leave Guy Benson alone now. We've been calling, this is a Guy Benson, the ballad of Guy Benson. And Mary Katharine Ham agrees that this song is all about Guy Benson, Rich Men North of Richmond. It's a fine song, by the way, and it was a clever way to open the show. But I am very frustrated at what wasn't asked. I mean, at the end of every debate, I said, what if you put a Republican, you know, partisan like me, and they ask questions about Joe Biden? They ask questions about, I mean, they were about to give $6 billion to the Iranian terrorists. What about that? We're about to send another cabinet member to appease Xi Jinping, Gina Raimondo, Secretary of Commerce. What about that? What about the fact the president doesn't know what he's talking about half the time and has to be guided off the stage? What about that? What about the Inflation Reduction Act that did not reduce inflation? What about, I mean, how do we have a Republican Party debate that does not bring up the collapse in Afghanistan, the anniversary of which we are living through, the consequences of which will endure? How do we do that? Because it's not a game show. It's not a game show. And there has been a slow movement towards the increasing control by the Republican Party of its debates. And it's accelerated some, but Chairwoman McDaniel and David Bossie got half right last night. They had an enormous audience, 25 million people. What did we do with that audience? Did any candidate say go to Win Red and help us take this country back from left-wing socialists who have no idea how the world works and from appeasement? Did anyone get a chance to give their website? Did anybody do other than make great television? Fox did a great job making great television. They did. And it was great television. I sit here thinking, this isn't a game. I've told this story before, but if you're a new listener, in 2005, I owed a book to Regnery. They said, what do you want? What do you want to do it on? I said, well, you know, I'm interested by this Romney guy in Massachusetts. I don't know that evangelical America will vote for a Mormon. And they should. Article 6 of the Constitution, there shall be no religious text. I said, let me write a book about him. And they said, okay. It took me forever to get in to see the governor. And then he was very cooperative. He was a friend. I like Mitt Romney a lot. I know some of us in this audience are upset with some of his positions, but I'm not. He's a wonderful human being, and he should have won the presidency. He had a terrible campaign manager, and Stuart Stevens is the reason that we got Barack Obama for 4 extra years. And we can't undo history. It's unfortunate that he botched the keynote address. It's unfortunate that Orca failed. It's unfortunate that Candy Crowley, who ran the debate because the presidential debate commissions are in the bag for the Democrats, interrupted his answer and sided with Barack Obama. That's all unfortunate. It hurt the country. But we run these debates. We Republicans run these debates. And it is not too much to ask to find fair partisans like me. All right, I have no dog in this fight. I want to beat Joe Biden. We have to beat Joe Biden or Gavin Newsom. It is not too much to ask to talk about the collapse in Afghanistan, not to spend all that time on abortion. If you're going to do abortion, and I'm fine with doing abortion, you say, we're not going to have an argument about abortion. We think it's important that you give us your position because it's a national issue. So we're going to go down the aisle and there is no right of response. You have 1 minute to state your position on abortion after Dobbs. And do it 8 minutes out of 120 is not bad. All right, I understand that. What we had, the food fight, that's just stupid. It's just stupid. The Republican Party should not allow that. Gary in Tampa, what do you think?
Sir, thank you for taking the call. I think your opening comments in this section are right on spot on target. And the question that put me on the air is asking for your help. How can we, in fact, influence the RNC? What happens in the next debate? How do we change it from being a presentation to something more substantive and advancing what we do and with fewer people on stage?
Well, the first thing you do is applaud them for doing number one. They've taken control of every debate effectively. And the moderators will be fine. They'll be at least the equal of Martha and Brett. And you applaud the good. Okay, always begin with the compliment. I am very glad we had 25 million people watch last night. I am very sad that the candidates did not make good use of their time. All right, that's not on Brett and Martha. Nobody has to answer any question. Do you understand that? Everybody out there, every candidate, you don't have to answer the questions asked. You can always say, Brett, that's a fine question, but I think you folks need to be asking about the collapse in Afghanistan, and we need to be honoring the Gold Star families who are watching and expecting some accountability for what happened at Abbey Gate. All right? I do not help any of these candidates, or I help them all. I would help them all by saying there are ways to do this. Go get Brett. Brett O'Donnell is the best debate coach in America. He was working with Pompeo and Cotton. I don't know who signed him on. Maybe Nikki did. She had the best single moment. But there is just no denying that 25 million people is good. Everybody wants an audience of 25 million people. But you got to use it. And so, memo to Rana and David, congratulations. You've got control. Now let's work on the question set. Let's get more control. Tom and Rose. So how do you change it? You send them a congratulatory note. You enclose a contribution. You say, we've got to beat Joe Biden. Here's my suggestion. Don't be an ass. Don't be an ass, all right? Don't be an ass. Tom in Roseville, Michigan. What do you think, Tom?
Morning glory.
Morning glory, sir.
That is the worst debate that I've seen in decades, okay? And I've been following policy since 1986. You hit it exactly right, okay? It looked like the junior high kids' food fight, yelling. And I didn't hear any substantive issue that would even encourage me to vote for any one of those candidates. We have so many important issues around the world, and I mean, they're talking about nonsense. I see nothing.
Well, there were some good moments. I think Doug Burgum brought up the fact that every time you buy a solar panel, cha-ching in China. But, you know, the existential threat to the United States is Xi Jinping, TikTok, the artificial intelligence revolution, and the Chinese Communist Party's intent on global domination. That is it. That's number one. We got to China at 82-minute mark in the debate, and then we left it soon thereafter.
The fate of the J6 protesters. Okay,
I don't care about J6. Someone did say Governor DeSantis has the right thought bubble here. Again, I got to be careful about how much time I use on this thing because Fox has got some pretty impressive warnings out there about not using their thing. But I'm looking for Ron DeSantis on. Well, let's play cut number 7, first debate. We didn't talk about the shutdown. How can we not talk about what Joe Biden did to this economy and how much money he spent and how they kept Fauci around? Cut number 6.
And a major reason is because how this federal government handled COVID-19 by locking down this economy. It was a mistake. It should have never happened. And in Florida, we led the country out of lockdown. We kept our state free and open. And I can tell you this, as your president, I will never let the deep state bureaucrats lock you down. You don't take somebody like Fauci and coddle him. You bring Fauci in, you sit him down, and you say, Anthony, you are fired.
All right, so that is, we ought to spend a lot of time on that. The 1 minute rule is terrible. 75 seconds is enough to get out the plane in the air. And the worst rule in the world is the right of response. And you know why networks love it? Do you know why networks love it? Is it because it creates moments that go viral that sell ads? I am not interested in moments. I am interested in donors and voters. That's what I'm interested in because we have to win. Norman in Virginia. Go ahead, Norman.
Hey, I watched the show and I really was disappointed as well. But one thing that comes to mind is that if you ask a bunch of questions that they can all agree on, then what are you gaining from that? I mean, you know, they're all against, they're all pro-life, for example. And so I'm not sure that just asking how much they hate Biden is going to be helpful.
No, I didn't say that. Come on, Norman, I didn't say that. I said, why are we talking about Afghanistan and its collapse? I don't want to ask how much you hate Biden. That's a stupid question. I want to know, why do you think we collapsed in Afghanistan? What was the commander-in-chief's fault there? And if you've read the book Kabul, you'll know the answer. And they all ought to have had a copy of Kabul in their dressing room, and they ought to remember to bring up Kabul, because if you can sell Kabul to the American people, if you can tell them about Kabul, they will now go and read and find out what an absolute fiasco that was because of Joe Biden, how he rejected everybody's advice. So it's not about saying bad things about Joe Biden. It's about bringing up the fact he's a terrible commander-in-chief. Thank you, Norman. AndrewandTodd.com. You know what they didn't bring up? No one brought up. No one can buy a house in this country who's under the age of 50. Why? Because house prices are high and interest rates are higher. Why did you hear anyone talk about interest rates last night? Do you know that every voter in America is out there talking to AndrewandTodd.com who wants to buy a house? And they're a sponsor of the show, 888-888-1172. And the first thing they hear is, well, your mortgage rate's going to be in the sevens because of Joe Biden. That's what, did you hear that last night? How do you bring down mortgage rates? Like that's a question that it doesn't take 30 seconds. I'd like to hear from the candidates. How do you bring down mortgage rates? How do you bring down mortgage rates? Because American families are dealing with it. How do you deal with the fact that cars cost more than they have ever cost and the supply has gone to hell? How do you deal with inflation? You know, they did it at the beginning and it was just talking. AndrewandTodd.com is one way to deal with the collapse in interest rates out there, the collapse in affordability. But you got to go to their website. You got to get started by calling 888-888-1172. I also want everyone to go to alec.org and then get richstatespoorstates.org. Because if you want to know why Ohio, Florida, Tennessee, Texas are prospering, if you want to know, it's because of their tax and business policies. And they are listed there. Did we have one question last night on the failure of blue state economies versus the success of red state economies? No, we didn't. Why does it happen? Every Republican in the country has a stake in these debates. Everyone running for every office. And you know all of it if you get richstatespoorstates.org. I would make my candidate, if I were their advisor, memorize richstatespoorstates.org. And talk about it on the, it's called the residual effect of a broadcast. If you promote something, it continues to promote in the echo afterwards. Nobody did that last night. It's like none of them have a debate advisor. I despair. I'll be right back, America. Doug Burgum was my guest, and I got some off-the-air stuff with him, which I want to share with him. Welcome back, America. I'm Hugh Hewitt. Former Vice President Mike Pence joins me now. Good morning, Mr. Vice President. You must be tired. I'm glad you made time for me this morning.
Good morning, Hugh. Thanks for having me on.
Well, I'm a little bit frustrated. Second anniversary of the collapse of Afghanistan. You're a military dad. You know, there are Gold Star families all over this country watching, and not one word about Afghanistan last night. What happened to that debate?
It was as frustrating as it was to you. It was to me, to be honest with you, Hugh. I mean, it's for us to have passed that that second anniversary. And I think when I talked about the failings of President Joe Biden, I mentioned the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan, but we didn't spend much time there. And I think that holding Joe Biden to account for that, explaining the cost there, and really, I actually wanted to speak about Corporal Humberto Sanchez of Logansport, Indiana, who was one of the 13 who fell, who refused to leave the gate that he was standing post at, even though he was warned that someone had gotten inside the wire, because he said there were all women and children in his line. And Karen and I went and prayed and wept when his remains came home. But we need to tell that story, because I really do think that weakness arouses evil. And so much that's happening on the world stage, whether it's the war raging in Eastern Europe, whether it's the military provocations of China, whether it's Iran back to its malign activities, are all begin at that disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan. I wish we'd spent more time on it.
My second major frustration, everybody on that stage genuinely agrees that Dobbs was rightly decided. What comes next is unknowable. Nobody talked about the fact that the Democratic Party is committed to packing the Supreme Court and destroying the rule of law. How does that not come up in a Republican debate?
Yeah. Well, look. Elections are about choices, and this is a primary. And I, frankly, you know, I welcome the opportunity to talk not only about my vision, my background, my experience. As I think, with all humility, Hugh, I think I am. I'm the most qualified, I'm the most tested, I'm the most proven conservative that's running for president of the United States in the Republican primary. So, look, I'm with you. I mean, I think making the point that the position of the Democratic Party today is to support abortion on demand all the way up to the moment of birth, to use taxpayer funding of abortion at home and abroad. And I've been a voice for calling them out. I think it's part of the equation of how we continue to win hearts and minds for life, is by articulating we're the party of the sanctity of life. They're the party of abortion on demand.
Now, Mr. Vice President, you've won 2 one-on-one debates. You demolished Kamala Harris. You beat Tim Kaine like a rug. This is not your best format, because you need a little runway to take off, because you're a serious man. What do we do about the rule set? Number one, Hugh Hewitt is king of the universe. Nobody gets a right of reply, because that's exploited by people who want to be their name ID to go high and get donors. That's number one. But what would Mike Pence do if you were setting the rules?
Well, look, I'm grateful for Fox last night. I think if I was setting the rules, I'd put Hugh Hewitt back at the table, asking questions and driving it. You've been there before. Look, this is the beginning of a process, and for my part, I was just profoundly honored to be on that stage. And I was glad to be able to joust with everyone on that stage and make our case, because this is such a serious time. And I wanted people to know the reason I'm running for president is because I think this country's in a lot of trouble. And whatever the format is in the days ahead, we're headed to the Reagan Library in about a month. We're going to step into that breach, and we're going to make our case, because I really do believe different times call for different leadership, and we're going to work our hearts out to earn the right not only to be a standard bearer for this party, but to defeat Joe Biden and be ready on day one to bring this country back.
Now, Mr. Vice President, I want to press you a bit on this. The live audience interfered with the debate significantly last night. Martha and Brett have a good question set generally, some big gaps that I just mentioned. But the live audience just screws it up. Now, I understand there's a reason every campaign wants donors, but do we need that many people cheering and crowding? And I mean, people couldn't hear the candidates.
Well, I'll let people judge that we're watching it on television. For my part, I welcome people in the stadium. I thought that the there wasn't a bad seat in the house. I think all of us had our supporters in the crowd, and frankly, there was a lot of universal support for statements that we made, that others made, and I love the interaction. Look, we're ultimately taking our case to the American people, and I hope in the debates, in the days ahead, whatever the format is, that we have the Republican voters who are present there, who have the opportunity to react there, and that we have the chance to speak directly to, not just through the television cameras, but in person. It was a great privilege.
Last question, Mr. Vice President. Mike Gallagher on this show, Chairman Gallagher of the Select Committee on the Chinese Communist Party, said these debates should pose the commander-in-chief test. In other words, if 9/11 happens, who do you want in the desk? Who passed that test besides yourself last night? You've been there. You've done that. You know what it is. Who else do you think passed that test last night?
Well, I'd let others be the judge of that, but I'm humbled by the fact that you said that we passed that test. You know, I really do believe the world's becoming more dangerous by the day. I hardly need to tell Hugh Hewitt that. You understand it. We both got families that are serving in the uniform of the United States, and it's not a time for on-the-job training. It's not a time for a rookie in the White House. And what I hope to communicate last night, and I'm humbled that you think on that score that we did, is that I'll be ready day one to build a military fitted to the times, and that I'll never hesitate to use American power to defend our interests and defend our allies around the world. And I'm prepared. With all humility, I believe I'm prepared more than anyone else on that stage to serve as commander-in-chief and lead this country to peace through strength.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President. We'll talk again before the debate in Simi Valley, and good luck in bringing up the corporal and the other warriors that we lost and other serious issues in the days and weeks ahead. Thank you, Mr. Vice President.
Thank you, Hugh. Always good to be with you.